I have to go directly to the issues raised, but I should like to make it a record that I submitted a 25-page position paper, to which is attached a 32-page speech I delivered before the MPC and other business entities. As to the first key issue, my answer is there is absolutely no need to amend or revise our constitution. Of the five constitutions of the Philippines, which the Philippines ever had, the Malolos Constitution, the 1935 Constitution, the 1973 Constitution, the Freedom Constitution of 1986, and the 1987 Constitution, only the 1987 Constitution has remained unamended for nearly 31 years. On 2 February 2018, it would be exactly 31 years. A serious previous efforts to amend it all failed. In 1997, during the term of President Fidel Ramos, there was a proposal by way of a people's initiative, the third mode of proposing amendments, to lift the term of the term limitations of elected officials. The principal objective was to allow then President Ramos to run for re-election in the elections of May 1998. Under Section 4 of Article 7 of the Constitution, the President shall not be eligible for any re-election. The People's Initiative proposal was filed pursuant to RA number 6735, or the Initiative and Referendum Law. But the Supreme Court, in its decision of 19 March 1997, in Santiago versus Commission on Elections, declared that the law was incomplete as worded and insufficient for purposes of the People's Initiative to propose amendments to the Constitution. Hence, the proposal was struck down. Then, during the term of President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, there was a second attempt, again by means of a People's Initiative, to amend the Constitution by changing the form of government from presidential to parliamentary. As was generally perceived, the purpose was to allow the then president, who was not eligible for election, to continue to hold on to power by being elected as prime minister. In its decision of 25 October 2006, in the case of Lambido versus Commission on Elections, the Supreme Court frustrated the move in light of the decision in Santiago case, and it was not, and it was also not in accordance with Section 2 of Article 17 of the Constitution. Until now, Congress has not amended that initiative law to cure its defects pointed out by the Supreme Court in the Secretary in Santiago case. In short, Your Honors, this 1987 Constitution has achieved an unsurpassed record of permanence, capitalized permanence. As explained by Justice Isagani Cruz in his book Constitutional Law, 2000 edition, page 7, permanence means the capacity of a constitution to, open quote, resist capricious and whimsical change dictated not by legitimate needs, but only by passing fancies, temporary passions, or occasional infatuations of the people with ideas or personalities, close quote. I would not hesitate to assert that our 1987 Constitution, even if imperfect, as none is perfect except God, is the best in the world, the best for our country and our people, not just of this generation, but even for generations yet unborn. It is the only constitution I know of which is pro-God, pro-Filipino, pro-people, pro-life, pro-family, pro-marriage, pro-poor, pro-human rights, pro-women, pro-environment, among others. It contains sufficient provisions against abuse of power and guarantees people's active participation in governance, including the use of people power. It is the only constitution in the world which institutionalizes the doctrine that a public office is a public trust, meaning that all government officials and employees are servants of the people, thereby enshrining the servant leadership principle which Jesus Christ himself proclaimed. I have yet to see another constitution which could surpass our present constitution. I know this constitution very well. I was among the commissioners of the 1986 Constitutional Commission who drafted it. With us now this morning are two other commissioners of the commission, Commissioners Ascuna and Ed Garcia. I submitted several constitutional reform proposals and introduced innumerable amendments to the proposed provisions which found their way into the various articles of the final draft of the Constitution. I actively participated in all the deliberations, both at the committee levels and at the plenary sessions of the Commission. When we voted on the final draft of the Constitution at the plenary session on 12 October 1986, I ended my affirmative vote with these words. Modesty aside, into this Constitution I have given my blood, towards tears and sweat. This is the Constitution I'm willing to die for. On several occasions in the recent past, I reiterated this solemn pledge. Now I do so once more in this public hearing. I will until I breathe my last. I am now 82 years old. Unfortunately, a massive majority of its provisions have not been implemented. There are myriads of provisions which require appropriate legislations to give life to them. The government and Congress are expressly mandated to do so, and these mandates appear about 150 times in the Constitution. You have also been informed of a recent survey result that only about 27% of the people know about the Constitution, and likewise observe with results that the vast majority of our people are not in favor of amending or revising the Constitution. I must underscore this basic principle. Anyone proposing to amend or revise the Constitution must first be an assiduous student of the Constitution, who has a full grasp of its contents and of the spirit and principles which are its cornerstones, and has found them, or some of them, to be stumbling blocks to the achievement of our people's dreams, hopes, aspirations, and longings, who has found that the Constitution cannot fully pursue or implement those for which the sovereign Filipino people have implored God's help in the preamble of our Constitution. Before entertaining any thought to amend the Constitution, our lawmakers and leaders should first meticulously examine its provisions, reflect on them, and ask themselves, have I taken enough steps to give life to or implement the provisions and the mandates of the Constitution? If they have not, or if they have done only a little, they should not be party to the mangling or tinkering of the Constitution. Now, on the second issue, it is very clear from what I said that there is no need to amend the Constitution. My answer, therefore, would be, as to the second issue, it would logically follow that the answer to the second issue would be there is nothing in the 1987 Constitution of the Republic of the Philippines which can stand amendment or revision. However, there are proposals to amend the same, and we have to consider these proposals. And among these proposals would be about the federal system. The chairman, however, had requested me not to discuss this anymore because there will be another setting for this, another time to discuss federalism. I have prepared a very extensive discussion on federalism. Probably another setting will be considered because that is related to the second issue. So another time may be taken for that, but it is in my position paper. There is a proposal that would have to be considered in relation to the third. This is the proposal on federalism. And I would like to say right now that a shift to federalism is a lethal experiment, a fatal leap, a plunge to death, and a leap to hell. I will take that up in another setting. Therefore, it is obvious that on the third issue, should the amendment or revision be re-federalism and other proposed constitution be by Congress itself as a constituent assembly or by a constitutional commission? My answer is it should be by a constitutional commission, convention. By a constitutional convention. The adoption of federalism with the current proposals in the lower house to adapt a new constitution for the Federal Republic of the Philippines with massive substantive changes of provisions of the 1987 Constitution would involve the massive overhaul of the 1987 Constitution. To ensure a truly impartial, comprehensive discussion on this crucial issue of federalism or the entry into our midst of a foreign invader, I especially submit that the matter be left to a constitutional convention with delegates duly elected by the people exclusively for that purpose, not as politicians. I propose that the election for the members of the convention be nonpartisan. There should be no rush, no hurry in the journey to adopt a foreign invader, a total stranger denied entry for about 120 years already. A very unusual rush and precipitate action to fulfill a current obsession or infatuation of our leaders, the federal system, would validate what I earlier described as a lethal experiment, a fatal leap, a plunge to death, a leap to hell. Now on the fourth issue. If the Congress convenes as a constituent assembly for the purpose of amending the Constitution, should the Senate and the House of Representatives vote jointly or separately? Section 1 of Article 17 of the Constitution provides, any amendment to or revision of the Constitution may be proposed by, one, the Congress upon a vote of 3/4 of all its members, or two, a constitutional convention. Note should immediately be taken of the fact that the section does not state whether, when acting as a constituent assembly, the Congress should be in a joint or in separate session. The following pronouncements of Father Joaquin Bernas on one of the commissioners of the 1986 Constitutional Commission, and a highly respected constitutionalist in his book, The 1987 Constitution of the Republic of the Philippines, a commentary, 2003 edition, pages 1298 to 1299, is very instructive. The provision says nothing about a joint session. The provision raises two questions. First, must Congress assemble in joint session before it can propose amendments or call a constitutional convention? Or alternatively, may the two houses, as they are, and who are there, they are proposed amendments or call a constitutional convention by a vote of 3/4 of the respective membership? Since nothing is said about a joint session, it is submitted that each house may separately formulate amendments by vote of 3/4 of all its members and then pass it on to the other house for a similar process. Disagreements can be settled through a conference committee. Alternatively, however, it is also submitted that Congress may decide to come together in joint session and vote separately or proposed amendments and revisions. Since the Constitution is silent about the method, and since the mandatory process has been committed to Congress under the political questions doctrine, Congress should be free to choose whichever method it prefers. It is also submitted, however, that what is essential is that both houses vote separately. This is because the power to propose amendments is given not to a unicameral body, but to a bicameral body. The meaning of a constitutional command can also be drawn from the non-governmental structure set out by the Constitution. I fully agree with Father Bernas. On the final key issue, Mr. Chairman, can Congress pass a resolution limiting the powers of the Constitutional Assembly or Constitutional Convention, or are there powers plenary? As to the Constituent Assembly, what Father Bernas had pronounced, and which I have just read, provides us the answer. If the Senate and the House act separately, as in the passage of an ordinary legislation, each House controls itself. If Congress should choose to sit in joint session, the first step would be for both Houses to approve a joint resolution calling for Congress to convene in joint session for the purpose of proposing amendments or revisions to the Constitution. The resolution for the convening may determine what should be taken up as proposed amendments or revisions, which would require the affirmative votes of the members of each House voting separately. If the resolution for a joint session to propose amendments or revisions does not specify what should be taken up, anything can be taken up. As to the Constitutional Convention, Section 3 of Article 17 of the Constitution provides, the Congress may, by a vote of 2/3 of all its members, call a Constitutional Convention. Can that call restrict the powers of the Constitutional Convention? The noted constitutional law authority, Enrique Fernando, in his book, The Constitution of the Philippines, second ed, page 17, said, a constitutional convention is a coordinate body with the main departments of the government entrusted with the duty of drafting a constitution for approval by the electorate. In performing such a function, it has full powers. It is not subject to the restraint by legislature or the courts, either as to what subject or subjects will be taken up or may be proposed. Only the people, more specifically those enjoying the right to vote, can set aside the action taken. That will be the end of my opening statement. I'm open for questions.